Hello and welcome to the Altair Student Webinar Series to the part of Design Composite Structures with Simulation. So that you know who's talking to you, I want to shortly introduce myself to you. My name is Marius Müller. I'm Altair Ambassador since 2018. I am holding a bachelor degree in mechanical engineering from Graz University of Technology in Austria. I am FEA consultant of Tier Graz Racing Team, is a student team which is participating in former students. Furthermore, I am former team principal of Terra Tier Graz, a team that participates in Shell Eco Marathon. Next to that, I'm part-time project collaborator at the Institute of Material Science, joining and forming at the working group Tooth and Forming at Graz University of Technology. Last but not least, and I'm really happy about it, I'm FEA engineer at PJ Messtechnik GmbH. PJM is a worldwide leading specialist in the field of railway system. The Austrian company was founded in 2006 and has successfully realized projects in 30 countries and 5 continents. We have about 60 employees at the Graz site to ensure 100% made in Austria. The company is divided in PJ Messtechnik and PJ Monitoring. PJ Messtechnik is an accredited test center by ISO IEC 17025 standard, focusing on approval tests for railway vehicles, like the suburban railway in Berlin, for example. PJ Monitoring is a technological leader in automation and digital systems for rail freight transport. Before we start with the topics, I want to shortly go through the agenda with you. Today we will deal with 2D meshing, then we head over to modeling composites, and then we will answer the question what actually optimization is, and at the end of the day we will do composite optimization. All right, let's get started with the last meshing type I want to show you in this webinar series. It's the 2D meshing. As you might can remember from the introduction webinar, 2D elements are usually used for defining blade-like structures. So basically, structures where one dimension is way smaller than the other two dimensions. You have seen shell or 2D meshing already in the 3D meshing part, where we use 2D elements for defining 3D elements. But now, today, we are using 2D elements to really for really defining a part and also to calculate with those elements. Now for the beginning, I want to do the following with you. We have a sheet. The material should be aluminium. And basically we just put a constraint here at this end and force this edge to move in the X direction with a specific displacement. We will constrain the plate here at this side with zero displacement. And then we will have a look at the displacements, at the stresses and strains at as color result, and then also as vector and tensor results. To do so, please open HyperWorks 2021 and follow my steps if you want. Okay, after opening HyperWorks, the first thing we are going to do is, like always, define our origin of our part. To do so, I'm going again to this geometry ribbon and click in on this point and define my origin point of my model here in the origin of my global coordinate system. With the mouse button to accept and escape. I'm opening my Components browser, and here I'm going to change the name of my plate and name it to shell plate and t2 millimeters. T2 millimeters stands for a thickness of 2 millimeters. You see, I am going to treat the length units as millimeters. My masses are in tons and my stresses should be in megapascals in the end. Okay, our plate, which we want to model, has a length of 150 millimeters and a width of 50 millimeters. To create our plate, I'm just going here to define shape. For our shape here, this should be 50 millimeters and this should be 150 millimeters. To directly create a surface, I just click here on fill shape and a surface was created. With the mouse button to accept and escape to leave this tool. I'm going to change the color of this plate to gray. I'm going to delete this point here by just choosing points here in this entity selector. I just press P on my keyboard, or you also can go here and select points. Draw a window, select this point and click on delete on my keyboard. So, okay, yeah. The next thing I wanna do is to actually move this plate regarding its coordinates. As you remember, we defined that our origin of this global coordinate system is here in this corner, but now I want to have it here in the middle of this edge. To do that, I'm going to make use of this move tool up here. Just click on it and I'm selecting surfaces here in this entity selector. Selecting this surface, and as you can see in the middle of this plate, the move tool will appear. I'm going to rotate the plate a bit. And now to actually move this move tool, you just can press shift on your keyboard and wait till the move tool gets highlighted like this here. And now you just have to drag and drop the move tool by selecting here with the left mouse button, the origin of the move tool, and drag and drop it to this corner here. You release the left mouse button and you also release shift. Then you can just click here on the Y and type in minus 25. And you can see that this whole surface was translated in the Y direction with a distance of minus 25 millimeters. I'm hitting escape to leave this tool, and to check if the origin is now really here, I'm going to create a temporary node in this middle of this edge. To do that, I'm going to use this tool here, create points. I'm changing to create edit nodes. And I'm going to the midpoint of this edge and just left mouse button. And you can already see the coordinates of this temporary node. Now it's 0, 0, 0. Middle mouse button to accept and escape to leave this tool here. And now I just show you another tool to check node coordinates, especially if you want to, if you have a mesh and you want to check your mesh nodes, you can go here in this entity selector tool, select nodes, and then you just double click on this node here. And then you can see, okay, my local coordinates are basically 0, 0, 0. Here it's just, something times 10 to the power of minus 15. This is everything is fine. Close. Since this plate is basically has a lot of symmetry planes, We are going to cut this plate into several sections, and we are going to mesh one section and just reflect this section. Then let's say we mesh one quarter of this plate, and then we are going to reflect it in this direction, and then all the elements here over the middle edge here in this direction. To split a surface, you know it already, we can make use of the split tool in our geometry ribbon. I'm going to split. Now you can either use interactive to just split from one edge to the other edge, and you also can use it to basically split from the midpoint of this edge to the midpoint of this edge. Or you can use this plane option, select two surfaces basically, and one tool here in the middle point, and you just have to define the normal vector of your splitting plane. Say split. That's it. You can just click escape to exit this tool. Okay, now we are going to delete this temporary node. I'm just choosing nodes here in my entity selector, draw a window over this load node. I'm sorry, draw a window over this node and just delete it by clicking delete on my keyboard. So now I'm going to mesh this area here. We have a length of 75 millimeters here, and this edge is 25 millimeters long. So I think element size of 5 millimeters should be satisfying. So I'm going to mesh. Go here to general 2D mesh, say this surface, select element size of 5 millimeters, go to the menu here. Element type should be quads and element order should be first. And then you can go to mesh. And if you're satisfied, you just can click accept by clicking the middle mouse button. If you want to update your mesh, you just click on one edge and you update the density of this edge. Okay, I'm satisfied with this mesh. This is at the moment wireframe. I'm just going to he here and make my mesh lines visible. Okay, perfect. Now we have defined this quarter. I'm going to reflect this quarter node to this side. To reflect elements, you can make use of the transformation tool. The transformation tool is hidden underneath this move tool. Here, if you click on this arrow, you can find the transformation tool, for example. You can translate elements, for example, but you also can rotate them, reflect, or scale them. I'm going to reflect elements, select those elements here, click OK. I don't want to create a new collector or new component. I want to keep the original collector. So basically, this gray collector here. Base node, this has to be a node which is on our plane we want to reflect about. So I'm just going to select this node here, for example. And then we only have to define a direction in which we want to reflect. This is basically defined by the normal vector of the reflection plane. And in our case, it would be the y-axis. So I just go here to y and enter 1. And if I click on apply, I just have to make sure that duplicate is ticked, because if you don't tick duplicate, those elements here would be reflected, but there wouldn't be here anymore. So just on this side. If I hit apply, now both elements, both sides are meshed. I'm going back to elements and updating my element selection. I still want to keep the original collector. I'm changing my direction to normal vector should be the x-axis because I want to reflect over the yz plane. And my base node should not be here, it should be here. Accepting it and click apply. I'm closing this transformation tool and now I have to make sure that my elements are connected to each other. So I'm going to make use of this validate and this free edge ribbon. Click on it, select here instead of components, I'm going to use elements. I'm selecting all the elements and say preview equivalence. And as you can see here, HyperWorks is telling us that 43 nodes were found. How does it find those nodes? If you run here in the yesterday's session, I will explain it again. Here we have a tolerance. You can set the tolerance to a value you want. It's free, you can set it to any value. And what does it do? Let's say we have those two elements here. And these two elements are not connected yet. That means we have two nodes in this region, two nodes in this region. And this tolerance basically says that this is a search intolerance. It's searching for nodes which have a distance from each other which is smaller than 0.01 millimeters. And as you have seen here, 43 nodes were found. And if you hit, for example, find edges, you see that a new component was created here in this components browser. This symbol here and edges. And this is always a good check to check element connectivity. If you find these edges in the middle of your mesh, your elements are not connected. To connect your elements, you go to delete edges again, select all elements again and say preview equivalence. Then you see which elements or which nodes are going to be equivalent. And if you hit equivalence now, those nodes are going to be equivalent. And if you hit find edges now, you can see that you don't have any free edges inside your mesh. This is good. This is exactly what we want. And now I'm going to delete edges and exactly leave this tool. The next thing we have to talk about is the element normal direction. As you might remember the 1D meshing, we said that we only have to mesh a line basically, so only a 1D mesh, and that we define the property of the cross section in the property card. And basically, we do the same with 2D elements. We define or we mesh a surface, define 2D elements, and the information about the element thickness is stored in our property. By using 2D elements, you can request results for your top face and your bottom face of the element. Think of a load case where you put an axial load on your plate. And as you might know, you would only get a stress value, which is constant over the thickness. But now think of a bending load, for example. You constrained your plate on one side and you apply a force on the other side. That means that you will get tension stress at the top face and compression stress at the bottom face of your beam or your plate. To request this, you can use this top and bottom face in Hyperview. I will show it to you later on. But for OptiStruct to know which face is the top face and which face is the bottom face, you have to define an element. You have to define an element normal direction. This normal direction is not only essential for defining where the top face and the bottom face is. It's also really important for load definition. And it also plays an important role in the definition of laminates, because in OptiStruct, laminates are stacked by using the element normal direction as stacking direction. All right, back in HyperWorks, we can have a look at the element normal direction by making use of the elements ribbon up here, and then we see here this normal ribbon. This is one way of checking element normal direction. The other way I will show you later on in the composite chapter. If you click here on adjust normal, you will see that one of the old panels will open. And here you can basically check the normals of elements. You can either leave this display to the elements, or I like to use elements in general. I mark all the elements here in which are defining my blade. I change from auto to element, and if I click now on display, you will see that the top face of this blade is colored red and the bottom face is colored blue. If I just rotate a bit here and change here from color display to vector display and type in a size for a display size, basically you can hit display and you can see the normal vector of each element. What you also will notice is that the red color defines then the top face of this element, and the blue color of the color display defines the bottom face. I like to display the normal direction by using color display, because as you can think of, if you have a huge structure and you only see arrows, so vector plots, it's quite confusing. That's the reason I like this color display. If I go now here and deselect all elements, and for example, I change the normal direction of those elements here in the middle, I just mark those elements and say reverse. You see that the color will change from red to blue. If I select now all elements and say display, you also see that the outer elements are now red colored and the inner elements are blue colored. If I change to vector build display, you will see that we have vectors pointing in the positive Z direction and vectors pointing in the negative Z direction. To adjust all elements in one direction, I just can select all elements and click here on orientation. Choose this element, for example. If you can remember, this element is colored red. And if I click on adjust now, you will see that all vectors are again in the same direction. This does this adjust tool do. Okay, we have defined our element normal vector, as I said, and I just want to repeat it. This element normal vector is really it's really important that you check it every time when you're dealing with shell elements, because of the said reasons, which are think of it, you define a load on it and your plates are bending, and out of a sudden you see, for example, one element shows tension stresses, and the other element out of a sudden shows compression stress, for example. The other important thing, if you do composite modeling, is that the stacking of your laminates will be in element normal direction, but more to this later. Okay. The next thing I want to do with you is I want to define the material, and then after defining the material, I want to define a property. Material, we have seen this quite often in this webinar series, is done by here in model. and here on this materials ribbon. Either you click here on create materials and you get this create materials window. I want to do it in the material browser now, so I click here on this disk. My material browser will open and I just can right click here, create material. I call it mat alumin alu for aluminium. And I make this entity browser bigger. We have a name mat alu and yeah, okay. Card image, I want to use mat 1. E-modulus is 70,000 megapascals. Poisson's ratio is around 0.34 for aluminum. And density is 2.7 times 10 to the power of minus 9 tons per cubic millimeters. Okay, material is defined. Next step, if you can remember after defining materials, is defining properties. So I'm just going to close this material browser and open my property browser here in the title bar. I select model and then here properties. List of properties. I go to my property browser, right click create. I call it prop shell for shell elements. Then I type in plate and plate alu and then t 2 millimeters because I want to assign a thickness of 2 millimeters to my plate. Now what you can see in the entity browser that card image is automatically pshell by default. So this time we can leave it pshell. Now we have to select the material. We are going to select material aluminium. And here this T is the thickness of your plate. So the thickness which is going to be assigned to those elements. As I said, it should be 2 millimeters. And that should it be so far, yeah? After creating properties, I have to assign the property to my component. I'm doing this here in my components browser. I go to shell plate T2 millimeters, and on property, I just select my created property. Now I rotate this plate a bit, and as you might can remember from the 1D meshing part, we made use of this visualization tools down here. We use this one to basically show or visualize the cross section of our 1D elements. And next to it here, it's basically the same, but for 2D elements, so for shell elements. When I click here on this 3D button, you see that automatically a thickness will be you will see that this plate, that we assign the thickness to this plate. So that you don't get confused. These are not 3D elements. These are really 2D elements with just an assigned thickness. You can leave this visualization tool by just deselecting this symbol. Perfect. The next thing we're going to do is defining boundary condition. As said in the introduction slide, I want to apply a force displacement on this edge and I want to constrain this edge. Furthermore, I would like to have an in-plane problem. That means I'm going to constrain all nodes in direction 3. Boundary creation, it's like we have done in the last two webinars. You just go to the model browser, say create, where are you, load collector. Just to repeat this again, load collectors are used to save boundary conditions and loads in one collector. It basically has the same, It does the same as the components, for example. Components are saving geometry and element information in this collector, and load collectors are saving single point constraints or loads into this load collector. Our first load collector should be the BC3. 3 stands for directional 3. As I said, we want to handle this, or we want to treat this as an in-plane problem, so I constrain all nodes on this plate. To do that, I'm going to analyze, click here on this boundary condition ribbon, go to constraint, only select degree of freedom number 3, set it to 0, select all the nodes here and say create. Adjust the size of this boundary condition just for visualization purposes. Click return. The next boundary condition I want to apply is a boundary condition which holds this the plate here on this edge here in direction 1, but at the same time it should allow the plate to have also transversal contraction at this edge. To do this, I'm going to create a new boundary, a new load collector. I call it BC1 for X direction. I give this one another color, maybe black, exactly. And this one gets the color green. And then I'm going again to boundary conditions, to this secondary ribbon constraints, and I'm going to constrain all those nodes at this edge here in direction 1. I'm saying create. I just hide BC3 to see if everything was defined. That's good. I just wanted to have it green. That's better. And now I want to put one boundary condition. I'm stay in this boundary, in this constraint panel, select boundary condition 2 and select this middle tool and say okay, please constrain the blade from moving in y direction at this point, and I say create. And this was okay. I go return, and I accidentally created my boundary condition in the wrong load collector. So I'm going to create a new load collector and organize my boundary condition in this new load collector, BC direction 2. To do that, I'm going to leave this boundary condition secondary ribbon and select loads, and then I'm going to hide this load here by just clicking on this triangle and say okay, I want to hide it. Okay, I see that this was my boundary condition in direction 2, so I'm going to show it again and just hide all the other boundary conditions here with the help of my model browser. Perfect. I'm going to organize this boundary condition in direction 2 now into this load collector boundary condition 2. I'm choosing loads here, choose this load here, and say O on my keyboard. I press O on my keyboard. Select destination, this should be boundary condition 2, so my load collector with the ID 3, and click here, and you see that my load was now changed to boundary condition 2. I can show boundary condition 3 and boundary condition 1 again, and boundary condition 2. Okay, perfect. The reason why I applied applied those boundary conditions like I did, or those single point constraints like I did, is the following. First of all, I wanted to treat this problem as a as an in-plane problem. That means I'm constraining all nodes in direction 3. What does this also do? If I constrain all nodes in direction 3, I'm constraining the rotation about X, the rotation about Y at the same time, and also the rotation about Z. So I fixed all three rotations with this boundary condition. Then the next thing is I applied boundary condition 1 in direction 1 on this edge, so that this edge cannot move in X direction. This is also clear. And in order that the plate is not flying away, because you cannot have one free boundary condition or more than one free boundary condition in your model, you always have to fully constrain your model, at least in all one time in all six directions. And to constrain it in direction 2, I just fixed one point here in this middle point. Why do I do it like this? I want to allow transversal contraction of the plate, not only here. I also want to allow it here. So when I pull here on this edge, every single node here can go in the Y direction and the minus Y direction and here in the plus Y direction. If you think about it, you pull here, volume of this material goes here, so the plate gets longer. But at the same time, this material, which is stretched here, has to come from somewhere. So this is this contraction, and you allow it here. If you wouldn't, or let's say it like this, if you would constrain the whole edge here in all three directions, transversal contraction would only be allowed to this node here, and this would be, for example, be the case for a welding seam. I hope this was understandable now, but we will see it in the results later on. Okay, we have now those boundary conditions. Then my last boundary condition I want to create is my boundary condition displacement. So I'm going to create load collector. I say this is displacement. I give it a color like this. I go again to analyze, I'm sorry, boundary conditions constraints. I choose this edge here, all nodes on this edge. Say okay, in the degree of freedom 1, I want to move all my nodes in X direction. I want to move it like this, that we have a nominal strain in the plate of 400 Newton per square millimeter. So I say that I want to move all these nodes in X direction with a direction of 0.0857. Okay. Try it again. Okay, now it's working. 0.857 millimeters. I do this, as I said, in order to get stress of 400 megapascals in the plate itself. Okay, perfect. Yeah. Since we, as we already know from the previous webinars, we only can have one boundary condition per load step. So we have to group all these created boundary conditions or constraints into one constraint to set this constraint in our load step definition. To do that, I'm going to use this SPC add card for a load collector. So I'm going to create my load collector. I call it SPC add. And here in the entity browser, I can change the card image from none to SPC add. It's here, not this. I'm going to use SPC add. I have 1, 2, 3, 4 boundary conditions, so I type in 4. Then this whole data set get changed and I can enter values in this table here. Here I'm able to group all my single point constraints. I will just do it very quickly. Boundary condition and the last is our displacement. Okay, Klaus, now we have one. Here up it's up here one load collector which has all boundary conditions saved inside. To run the simulation now, we have to create load step and tell the solver what is actually going to be simulated. So to create a load step, I again click in the model process, say create load step. I just want to call it step one. I want to do a linear static analysis. Single point constraint should be my SPC add load collector. And this time we don't have a load to define, so we can leave this field open. I'm just going down to the output requests. This time I want to have a displacement output. We leave the default here. I'm going to have where is it? SPCF. Also, this time we won't change the format to a text format. I just want to have a look at my reaction forces in the post processor, so I'll leave it like this. Then I want to have a look at strains and stress. And here I again choose corner data as location, and here as well corner data as location. So basically, that should it be with the load set definition or load step definition. If I go now want to analyze my this structure here, you know it already. You just go to analyze up here, go to the analyze ribbon and click on display button. You choose somewhere where you can want to save it. I say metal blade displacement or force displacement. Is it actually force displacement? Okay, and there I just leave it as metalblade.fem. I'm going to save it. Export options, I want to export everything. One option, I don't want to run an optimization yet, I want to run analysis. And the rest can be default. If you hit OptiStruct, OptiStruct should calculate this model if you have defined everything right. It seems that we have defined everything right. We just wait a few seconds till this problem is solved. As you can see, we again get maximum displacement. It's basically our force displacement we put on this edge right over here, and we don't see any error or warning messages in our field here. I close this window and open this double window over here and open Hyper View in the second window, which will open then. Here I load the model, the result file into Hyperview and have a look at my displacements. Opening result file is again here. Then I choose Metaplate H3D here and I hit apply. And then I'm going to show my mesh. I'm going to rotate it to the top and I'm going to show displacement by clicking here on contour panel and hit apply. I'm going to change from magnitude to X direction, hit apply, and then I'm going to change the legend over here. I'm going here to legend, say edit legend. I want to have a fixed scale or fixed numeric format. Three digits is fine for me. I want to have, let's say, eight colors. I want my color down here, it should be gray, and that should it be. I hit apply, and if I click on OK, you can see basically the deformed colors. If you want to see the deformation, you can just click here on Tools, Deformed, and you can change this value to 100, for example, and then you can see that this edge is pulled in the X direction, and since we set our boundary conditions so that we allow transversal contraction, you see that we have a constant transversal contraction over the whole length of this blade. So, and if you're asking yourself if you can plot undeformed and deformed shape at the same time, yes, that's possible. You just go here to undeformed shape and you go to show, and you want to, for example, show features. Then you go to color. You say, okay, I want to color my the part on my own, and then you can see that the undeformed shape is colored here in this features frame, I would say, and the deformed shape is still overplayed with the elements but deformed, yeah, with a scaling factor of 100 or deforming factor of 100. And here you again can see this transversal contraction, that it's constant over the whole blade. To just close this deform tool, I just enter 0 again here in this value field and basically close this panel. To now measure the displacement of every node here, you can do the following. You can basically create a diagram and let HyperWorks show you the deformation of every single node, or the displacement of every single node. To do that, you can go here to this Create Edit Meshes. And there you can just add a new measuring group. You can say, okay, node distance between, you go to node path, and you select just one node here, maybe one node here, and one node here. What you can see, this node path option does the following, that you just have to click two or three nodes, and HyperWorks automatically recognizes those nodes, that these are in a row, and it will show us the results of every node in a diagram now. To create a diagram, we just go here on Create Curves. Then HyperView or HyperWorks is asking us what we want to do. We say we want to create a new plot. We want the y-axis as value and the x-axis as distance. And after hitting OK, we can just go here to this Restore Down, and you see that we have three windows now on our page. The first window is now Hyper Mesh. Second window is HyperView, and the third window is HyperGraph. You can see here now that we have for every node, we got a specific displacement. And of course, with our material model, it's a linear curve. All right, the last thing I want to show you is again here in this HyperView window. I'm clicking here in this graphic area of HyperView and maximize this window. I'm going to untick this measure group 3 so that I don't see this node path here in my model, and I'm going to close this panel afterwards. Now I would like to have a look at these trains in my elements. I'm going here to contour panel again. Instead of displacement, I'm choosing elements trains. I'm going from, we have for Mises, for example, we have P1 major stress or P3 minor stress. We have, for example, in-plane stresses. We have shear stresses to choose, or we can also choose stresses in several directions. I'm going to choose XX right now because we forced this edge here to move in the X direction. So we will have a normal strain in X direction. So I click this here. Layers, I can leave max. But if you have a look here, you can see that we have, if you go down here, set one and set two, this is the top and bottom layer, as I explained to you on this presentation slide. But I will leave maximum so that my maximum values will be shown or will be displayed. Then I'm going to resolve it in. It should be the global system. So when you're using these directions, you have to make sure in which system you want to display your strains. For example, it could be that you have a local coordinate system, so for example, somewhere defined on your plate or in your model, and you display strains in your local coordinate systems, and maybe you get surprised why the results look like they look like. So my keep an eye on this and choose the white system. I go with the global system because X is pointing in this direction. I say component display and say apply. Now that you can see that the whole blade is basically gray. The reason for this is that our strain in X direction is the same for every single element. Our legend starts at 0.006 and ends at 0.006. To change this, you go here to legend, edit legend, and just type 0 inside here. And then you get this basically this distribution of numbers over from 0 to 0.006, and you hit apply and OK. And what you can see now is that you have every element is shown in red color, and this means if you have a look at this picture as it is right now, you can say, okay, my strains are between 0.005 and 0.006. Another tool to show strains or also stresses is this TensorFlow. If you click here, you can show element strains and layers already also at the mid layer, at the top layer, or at the bottom layer. I'm going for mid right now, and I say element displayed. And if you hit apply, you will see P1 major, P2 mid, and P3 minor strains. So far, that's all I want to show you in this metal plate tutorial for now. The next step would be to save this model and to make a composite plate out of this metal plate.